The Swell Season Podcast is recorded by the NewsStand Studio at Rockefeller Center in the heart of Manhattan and is distributed by the Swell Season Surf Radio Network. Hello, and welcome to the Swell Season Surf Podcast. I'm your co-host, Tyler Brewer.
And I'm your co-host, Karen Song.
Karen, it's been a hot minute. What's going on?
I know. Well, I got laid off recently, so now I have a lot more time to do this again. But I can't talk about the details of anything.
Their loss is great. Our benefit.
Hey, you know, the timing of it couldn't have been better. We had a great swell literally like the day after. So it was like, okay, goodbye. I had like all this time. It was the best.
And now it allows you time to work on your special projects.
Yes, many. I'm probably busier now than I was before.
Exactly. So does this mean you're going to move back to New York or what?
Still up in the air. The surf has been too good. It's hard to imagine.
You should be miserable here with me, ankle high surf. Come on. I mean, seaweed. We got sharks roaming the lineup now.
I know. What's up with that now? My God. I mean, it seems crazy. And I think they just shut it down recently also for like pollution, like bacteria levels. This is crazy.
Some weird bacteria bloom. Yeah, you should be back here. It's way better.
Oh, gosh.
We have an awesome show here. Yes. I'm super excited. So here, we'll basically introduce for our listeners. You know, we're sitting down here with the subject and the filmmaker of the film Gender Outlaw, Tyler Wilde and Peter Williams. Gender Outlaw is a story about
the
resilience.
Who's the subject?
Well, we will go into that. You know, Tyler Wilde is the subject and Peter is the filmmaker. Thanks for calling that out. But this story is it's about resilience and acceptance that Tyler found and that many transgender individuals have had to explore in their personal journeys as they go through their transition. And Tyler is like really honest and raw about this process in the film, but he also shows us how the joys in his life, body surfing, and his unexpected community have helped him find his true self. And it's just a really incredible film. And I'm really excited that we have both Peter and Tyler here to discuss it. Peter, Tyler, welcome to Swell Season.
Yeah, welcome. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us. We appreciate it. We're stoked to chat with you.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I've actually seen the film a few times. I really, really enjoyed it. And so many questions at the top. But I guess just from the, you know, how did you guys meet? You know, where did this project come about? Oh, Tyler wants to ask something before that.
I do think, though, it's really important we address and discuss, you know, some of the biases and discrimination that comes along with your choice to identify as a body surfer. I mean, it's very much, you know, a very, very
Before we get into it, yes, we need to clarify.
Touchy
this
subject, you know. I mean, a lot of stand-up surfers, you know, have these weird biases against it, you know.
I know, and then you get the foilers involved, and wow.
Oh gosh, don't get me started on the suppers. Come on.
We're gonna start with talking about the hierarchy of surf, which is a great debating topic. Yeah.
Very inclusive here.
Tyler, do you want to talk about how we met, Tyler Wilde?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I'll give the short and sweet version. Peter and I both live in the South Bay, and basically Peter stalked me in the water. No, I'm just kidding.
My wave, kook.
He drove me out of the lineup. No, we met, he was surfing and I was body surfing down in Redondo, and one thing led to the next, and all of a sudden we were making plans to surf with one another. And just through that chit chat in the water, getting to know one another, one day Peter was just like, hey, so I'm kind of this producer, and I think you're kind of cool. Do you want to do like a 2-minute IG or like YouTube, like short, just like a little vignette? And what he really sold me on was, I'll block for you and I'll buy you beer. And I was like, well, duh. Okay. And, you know, it started off as a friendship that he ended up bribing me into this project with beer and blocking for me. And I'll let him take the rest of the story from there.
I mean, check it out. Like, I've always been a huge fan of body surfing. And I mean, the whole debate about the hierarchy of surf is like hilarious too. But, you know, I saw Tyler body surfing actually at a really big day at a spot. Yeah. Down by Redondo, and said, what's up. And yeah, you know, I started following Tyler on social. We became friends, and yeah, that sort of the moment of revelation of asking Tyler about doing the documentary, it was kind of around the same time as the Gillis Beach Body Surfing Association contest. They do an annual contest in Manhattan Beach, and you know, talked to Tyler about kind of telling this story, but I really thought it was going to be that quick sort of short snackable piece of content. And I think the dream is you go and you shoot a day, and all of a sudden there's this rapport and you've got this great interview, and then it becomes a deeper story. And then we're like, well, fuck, we're both surfers. We need to get some great surf content, and we need to get more water footage. And then it was like one day after another day. And shout out to our DP, Gabriel Vargas, who's just like a dream to work with. Got his investment, his you know, technical expertise on it. And then I think I did a little bit of a rough cut. Tyler remembers my famous rough cut. It started with a very weird niche Doors track. It was very somber. I don't even know what it was like. But it did give you a little bit of a lead in that there's something here. And we all got a little bit of like a goosebump moment of, cool, there could be a greater, bigger story. And I think like, what I've said kind of from the beginning into now is, it's not my film, it's our film. It's a collective. We all part of Cross Step Content. We all made it together. Tyler's an EP on the project as well. Like, we invested our time into creating the story, and it just built and built and built. And I think like fast forward 9 months, a year later, we've got this like short documentary that really tells a synopsis of finding your one's identity, but also one's community in surf, and the juxtaposition of like being a part of an OG body surfing crew in LA that like at face value feels like a bunch of old white dudes that might not include someone who's transgender. That when I went body surfing with Tyler, I look at these guys and I'm very intimidated because I look at them, they're all old lifeguards. You know, you see these old salty guys, you know what I mean? This is the barnacle crowd. You see them, you're like, man, I respect these guys so much, but like, to be included within that and to see the relationship with Tyler was like, we had to give it the most dedication and devotion possible to tell Tyler's story. And we can get into this a second later, but also we tied a great benefactor to it, the Trans Latina Coalition. So not only are we telling Tyler's story, but we're also drawing awareness and sort of attention to a great cause as well, and raising money for that cause too.
That's great. That's great. Tyler, do you want to add any? Tyler Wilde, do you want to add anything?
Yeah,
to that?
Wrong Tyler. I was like, wait, no, I'm not.
When Peter approached you and was like, let's do a film, what was your kind of impression? Or
yeah, well, you know, my impression, other than the free beers and the I'll block for you part, that's really, I'll just come back to that. I mean, to get blocked for as a body surfer is really nice, especially where I'm at, where I'm just getting it dropped in on left and right. But the other part of it too, there was a little bit of hesitancy there. Cause I mean, I knew Peter enough, like, you know, people in the lineup, I was recognizing him. We had good rapport, but, you know, to let somebody into that inner circle and something Absolutely. That's really vulnerable. Mm-hmm. And then also I was in the process, and I still am, you know, I was just starting my medical transition. I was really in flux with a lot of things. And so to let somebody in on that process and also to have it recorded and then put out to public was a little nerve wracking at first, for sure. But my take on this is just there needs to be more trans stories out there that are positive, and more mm-hmm. people, more trans people telling their own stories. And Peter allowed me to have some creative input and put myself as an EP and have that platform. And so that was an offer I couldn't turn up, because it's just really important at this time in the history of media and film to get more stories out there.
Can I just plus Absolutely. One thing Tyler Wilde saying really quick, and I'll zip it. But I, as like a, what they would call sort of a cisgendered white male, like I come from a very different side of like perspective and privilege. And I've always, like, since I've known Tyler, I've always kind of looked up to him a lot of ways and thought like his position and his attitude is just so admirable. And his like definition of stoke is so admirable too. And I think like a lot of people talk, but like, you know what they say, action speaks louder than words. Part of my privilege is being able to make films and be able to invest in creating, like taking something from concept into to fruition. And I, you know, not to get religious or anything, but I felt like it was almost a calling to be like, Tyler, you're so eloquent, you've got such a great story, there's so much adversity around the topic of transness and surfing, especially right now too, we need to get your story out there. And like, that's part of me and my community being a vehicle to help tell Tyler's story that I felt like I had to do. And it's always felt like gut check. It always felt right, you know?
What was that moment you said there was like a, while you're shooting and doing a little more and a little more, and then all of a sudden the goosebumps hit. Like, what was that moment? Do you remember?
I do remember. I was down at, I'll drop some spots, but I was down in Bolsa Chica surfing with Gabriel. Don't say it. The whole crowd's going to show up.
Oh, it's over.
Tyler's shaking his head. Yeah, like,
I shouldn't have done it. You know what? Edit that part out. It's all good. No, but I was there with Gabriel, with his girlfriend at the time. We're surfing. And I actually, we had to exchange hard drives for like nerdy stuff when filming. And I'm like, okay, cool. I need to back up this drive, give you a drive. And I was like, but check this rough cut out. And I think I'd been just, you know, really editing night after night. And I'm not an editor, but I know enough to like kind of, you know, make something. And it was that point of showing that rough cut that I was like, you've shot something really beautiful. And Tyler's got such great words. There's some chemistry there. But I did realize, Karen, like out the gate, that there was a wall that I was hitting, that I have a vision in my head, but I don't have the right tools for myself to tell it. So I brought in Nick Gartner, who's like a world-class editor. We've worked together on the commercial side for years. And I called him up, kind of like phone a friend style. And I said, Nick, I'm in pretty deep. I need your help. This is the status on this. Can you jump in and help me make this thing? And he's like, you know, if Gabriel's providing, you know, the canvas and Tyler's the subject, it's like, you know, Nick is the painter. He's the one putting all the ingredients to paper and like really creating the right articulation of my vision possible. And that's when it went from something that was like a hook to being like, wow, this is like becoming a thing, you know, getting some momentum creatively.
Mm-hmm. And also I wanted to get back into the, I'm sorry, go ahead, Tyler.
No, go, go. No, go, Karen.
I wanted to get also into the kind of nitty gritty of Tyler. other Tyler's relationship to body surfing. Like, how did you get into it? What's your kind of relationship to the water? Even before you transitioned, and like your access point to body surfing.
Absolutely. So I grew up in Orange County, and my dad was a bodyboarder. I grew up, I can't blow up T Street. It's already blown up. So here we are.
Don't worry. It's a shit wave anyway.
Exactly.
Come on.
It's terrible. It's awful.
Yeah. Awful. So I grew up bodyboarding down there, and that was, you know, like as a kid, that was our favorite thing to do, and eating those corn dogs right there on the beach, you know, like that was like what I grew up doing. Yeah. And eventually got into longboarding, you know, just all in that area, all the typical places you'd go for longboarding in that area. And I just grew up along the water. Like, that was just my childhood. I played basketball, and I went to the beach, basically. Fortunately, surfing didn't get me into college. Basketball did. So when I went to school, I stopped surfing for a while. And when I graduated...
What position?
I was a point guard. I played in a small liberal arts school up in Oregon. I would have surfed there because I was pretty close to a really good break, but 48 degrees and my poor Southern California skin did not mesh well. I tried and I was purple within like 2 minutes.
Oh my God.
But I wasn't never into body surfing at the time. I surfed, I longboarded, I bodyboarded. And it wasn't until, I moved back, not to Orange County. I moved from Oregon to LA area where I am now in Porto. And, an ex-girlfriend of mine was like, "Hey, can you teach me how to surf?" And I was like, "Yeah, Team Costco all the way. Let's do this." So I'd push her into waves and, of course I'd body surf to go get to shore and help her paddle back out. And through that process, I was like, wow, this is pretty rad. I forgot how fun this is, you know? And then I was not paying as much attention to her. We ended up breaking up and and then the body surfing.
It happens.
I was more enthralled with just being like massively barreled way more than I ever got longboarding or bodyboarding. And I was like, why do anything else? And I've been hooked ever since. And that was probably, like 10 years ago, 11 years ago.
Oh, wow. That's amazing. And then kind of fast forwarding to the film. There was a moment in the film where you did say that body surfing saved your life. Is that something you could expand upon? It sounded like there's some, obviously, you know, difficult times that you're going through in terms of your transition. Like, what did that, what was that, you know, what was that moment like for you?
Yeah. We can go beyond the film because it was more than just my transition at the time. I actually didn't even start transitioning until 5 years ago. And I came out, I came out 5 years ago and I didn't even start transitioning really until 2019. So when I say body surfing saved my life, it's more because I was going through a lot of really heavy depression, anxiety, some stuff that was happening privately, that familial things, and just a lot. I was kind of a wreck. And when I turned away from surfing, when I turned away from even basketball, I turned into some other vices. And it kind of wound me in a spot where I was floundering. And when I got back in the water, and I didn't mean to get back in the water, I would have been on party train. But because this one person was like, "Hey, let's get in the water together." I think she probably heard some stories about me and how happy I was in the water. She kind of coaxed me. And then it was like, oh my gosh, I didn't realize what I was carrying and what I needed to shed. And it was almost like a baptism of sorts. I kind of felt just really renewed. And like, I had a second shot at turning things around from where I was.
Wow. That is what a fortuitous call this person made, and just gave you enough space for you to, create space in terms of how you were before and what you're going through, and then gave you this kind of reminder of this access point that was such a source of joy in your childhood and throughout your life. That is so beautiful. Wow.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm curious, like then, like in the timeline of getting back and where was that, before the transition or during it, if you don't mind me asking?
It was before my transition, and it was before I even came out as trans at all. I think a lot of some of the underlying stress and anxiety and things that I didn't have words for at the time, like body dysphoria and gender dysphoria and feeling really isolated and not knowing why, because I didn't have the, you know, there were no real role models for me at the time. Not saying that there weren't trans people out there, but I just was kind of in my own little world, and there wasn't a lot of visibility out there. And so all of this was going on before I even knew that I was trans. There was just like that kind of like a rip, just undercurrent that was kind of taking me, and I didn't really know how to get out of it. And then when I finally had the resources to kind of put a name to the things I was feeling, it started to make a lot more sense.
Great metaphor.
Yeah.
Right. We got to keep it. It's amazing.
It's amazing what verbalizing or being able to verbalize what you're experiencing can do for your well-being and your mental state. I find like just knowing that there is something that you're experiencing and there's a name to it, I think really helps a lot. And just understanding like, oh, okay, this is not just me, and this is a thing that people have experienced, which I think can be very, I think like that's why this film is actually really important for a lot of people to see, because there are a lot of people out there who may not have the vocabulary or the awareness or the understanding, or they may be afraid to really confront or be, you know, understand it, you know? And I'm curious, like, what has the response been to the film so far? How has it been received?
Tyler Wilde, do you want to jump in?
Yeah. you know, for me, it's been actually really incredible because, well, to comparatively explain, when I first came out as gay back when I was 18, so we're talking 2002, I had a really negative experience. And I was really isolated and really alone. And it was really, really challenging to come back from that. Ugh, I lost a lot of relationships.
I'm sorry, this hurts my feelings. This is in 2018 that this is like this. It's, it just it's hurts my feelings. That, yeah, it just really hurts to know that so recent, you know, with all the things that have changed in these decades, that it still is like this for folks to come out. It just breaks my heart. I'm queer, by the way.
Thanks.
So it's just, yeah, you know, the struggle is just like, oh my God, really, we're here still. Like, it's just, you know, like 2018 is yesterday. It's just crazy. Right. I mean, not yesterday. It's like today. You know.
I mean,
so I'm sorry.
Yeah. It's quite all right. I mean, I'm here, and now, you know, we've come out with this film, and I've come out as trans, and it was like an entirely opposite experience. So when I came out as queer, and I want to clarify, I came out when I was 18. That was back in 2002. Y'all viewers can't see me, but I do look very young for my age. Thank you so much.
I want to know your skin routine later, by the way.
Well, I would say it's testosterone, but you have some of that. So I'm just, because I'm going through my, I'm going through my second puberty. So that's what makes me look so young. But when I came out as trans, and when I came out with this film with Peter and sent it to my family and got everybody to come to our premiere, it was like a celebration of me. I mean, yes, of the film and of what Peter and I and Gabriel and Nick and everybody else created, but it really felt like a coming out party. I was like, hell yeah, this is fantastic. And a lot of people, especially because of COVID, hadn't seen me. Because I started transitioning medically during COVID. So they hadn't seen my face or heard my voice. And so it was just like a, just a complete party. And I've never felt so celebrated for my queerness, not in spite of. It was just really, it's been really rad for me.
Oh, I love it. That's amazing. And, you know, as far as what you hope this film would do in terms of creating visibility for, you know, not just trans people, water people, but just any definition of folks in the water, relating to the water, like beyond the binary. I think there's so much room for, I mean, there's so many more stories to be told. And I think we've only touched the scratched the surface of this kind of visibility, you know. And when you think about the ocean and ocean life and all the kinds of people who have relationships to the water, it is so non-binary. It is so diverse and complex and beautiful. And, you know, I just see this in a lot of the radical kind of like farming queer communities, this kind of idea of queerness and how it's applied into farming to tackle the idea of the binaries that exist there, as far as like how they exist as arms of corporations and industrialization and colonization and, you know, all the ways in which the binaries, you know, oppress or suppress like our humanity, and also have these negative effects on the environment. And, you know, it just goes on and on and on when we have these categories and ways of kind of like folding everything into these neat little binary boxes, you know. And I just feel like with the ocean and all the stories around the ocean, we have to break out the narrative beyond what, you know, what the corporate surf culture has kind of, you know, defined it in this monolithic way, and for very specific reasons, you know, which is capitalism at the end of the day, you know? So that, I think,
I was going to say that brings me to this really interesting quote that's at the bottom of your emails that I love. And I think it's appropriate to kind of mention as we discuss this, you know, it's a quote by Audre Lorde that you have, Tyler.
Great Audre Lorde.
And it's beautiful. And I don't know, do you want to read it or do you want me to read it? I mean,
your voice is so silky smooth. Feel free to read it.
Well, so quote, in our work and in our living, we must recognize that difference is a reason for celebration and growth rather than a reason for destruction. And that to me, like, is, you know, I guess like in the surf world right now, it feels like the trans conversation has come front and center in culture in general. It's become, you know, something that has really become a forefront of the culture wars. And unfortunately, you know, surfing, you know, it's really become a lightning rod of a discussion on, you know, where there's a lot of closed-mindedness. And with surfing particularly, I feel like the beauty of it is that you can do it any way you want, you know, despite what I said at the beginning about body surfing. No, it really is like you can ride a wave on an inflatable. You could ride it on a surf mat, a bodyboard, a foil, an SUP. You know, there's so many ways to celebrate. You would think the surf world particularly would be quite open to people and make it so it's not binary, you know, that make it like many of us ride a longboard, ride a shortboard, ride a boogie board, ride anything kind of mentality. And I just feel like I struggle sometimes with the surfing world, and particularly like the industry, you know, or the core culture and how it accepts certain things and how closed-minded it can sometimes be. I don't know where I was going with this. I'm sorry. Like, I was just curious, like your thoughts on that, you know. And Peter, I think you kind of wanted to step in here.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to chime in. I think it's something that Tyler really pushed me on. At the end of the day, this is a surf film. Like, yeah. Gender Outlaw, it's a story about body surfing, right? It goes back to the ocean. And I think like our core sort of takeaway is the ocean is a place of inclusivity, right? Black, brown, white, gay, straight, doesn't matter. You know what I mean? Like, if you go out there,
the ocean doesn't care.
Yeah, there should. Yeah, the ocean doesn't care. And we say this in the film. Tyler says this in the film. The ocean doesn't care. You know, it'll knock you out, and it'll accept you too. You know, it's a little bit, little bit of both sides. But I was also going to just kind of track back and say, like, in terms of like reception of the film too, just like a couple other really important parts. Like, we celebrate the film in a lot of different ways. The first premiere, I could barely hold back my emotion. I think I was so impressed at the fact that we actually made something and we could share it with people. But moreover, and Tyler, we were chatting about this right before the record, is like showing it to people for the first time outside of your bubble. You all of a sudden, your ears perk up because it's almost like you're in a cave. So you can start hearing what people, the gasps, the laughs, the cheers, the hoots, the hollers when Tyler's getting barreled, then the tears and the emotion of like the struggle behind it. And you know, the biggest sort of note here is that, again, it's a surf film, but it's a film about how Tyler has found his position in surf and then Tyler's identity around that, you know? And we've celebrated that in every single, at the initial premiere, at the screenings, at the festivals. But the cool part of it is like, as corny as it sounds, like the gift that keeps on giving, we're getting to celebrate that again in this conversation. It's that it's creating a space for this conversation. And I think that's what gives back to me the most as a filmmaker, is not only can I be friends with Tyler, but then we get to have this conversation with you and your audience about the topic, which is, that's all we ask for, is to have a conversation. Don't put a label on it. Don't reject it. Like, have a conversation. Listen to this podcast. Tyler's a normal person. I'm a normal person. We love surfing. We love Stoke. Watch the film. If you like surfing, if you like barrels, if you like good waves, you got to be an asshole if you don't like it. You know what I mean? Like, it's good. It's good. It's good. It's good. So I don't know. Just wanted to share that point.
And we will be right back. And now back to our show.
Actually, speaking of inclusivity and being kind of embraced by community, let's talk about the Gillis Body Surfing Association. What's their full name there? It's just like so rad. I just love it. And also is kind of reminds me of also, you know, all the prone surfers that I know are kind of like a band of misfits. And it's so fun. It's just the funnest group of people. So like when they appeared on screen, it was like, yes, of course. It was just such a moment of joy. And like, tell us about who they are and about how Gillis. You came across them. Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. So the name of the association is the Gillis Beach Body Surfing Association. And it was founded in 1964 by a handful of guys that went to Westchester High. And back in the day, before the marina was built out, Gillis, which is now under the LAX flyover, so there's like nothing there anymore. It used to be like a macking wave. In the summer, it'd pick up the south. It was super exposed, huge in with northwest in the winter. But when the marina was built out, it effectively demolished that wave. And I think that was sometime in the 70s. And then Vietnam happened, where a lot of our Gillis brothers went. With the desecration of that wave, and then also with a lot of people moving and kind of getting on with their lives, the club started expanding and we found a new home in Manhattan Beach. So just south at the Manhattan Beach Pier.
Gosh, it's 56 years old. That's crazy. Yeah. That's amazing.
And I make a joke that, like, you know, the median age is like 60 something, but it's true. I mean, like, you know, like, I think there's some of our oldest members. I mean, the guy that I surf with the most is 76 and he's charging.
Amazing.
We went to Noops. Yeah, we went down to Newport to like get some of that Frank swell, and he's just out there killing it.
That's another story that we haven't seen in surf either. You know, the ageism that exists in surfing also is, you know, pretty intense. So that's amazing to see that as well.
And I just ran into him because when I started body surfing, I was in Porto getting dropped in on a lot. And I was like, I need to find another spot. So I just rode my bike down the Strand and I was like, how about here? How about here? And I just happened to see these guys body surfing at the pier. And I was like, well, shoot, like, I'm going to go with these guys. So
it's the best.
It took, yeah. So I showed up and I was like, hey guys, you know, like at the time I was pre-transition. I had, I had boobs. So there's that. But I was just like this cute little surfer girl to them. They're like, come on in. I think they were mostly attracted to me, you know, like who's this chick? and like, we joke about it now, but it took me a while to break into their family. And that's kind of how it went, is that they're a group with, you know, almost 60 years of history. And because of that, in order to get in the group, you're really being inducted into their family. It's more than just like a group of guys that body surf. We had a paddle out this last year for one of our fallen brothers, and there's people that get married and we show up to their weddings, and you know, it's a family. And so when I went through the process of getting invited to be a member, voted into the membership and the whole nine, wow. It was like, it's not just meeting the couple guys that I go out with. I had to meet everybody. I had to talk to everyone, and everybody had to say that I was cool enough and a good enough person to be a part of the fam. It was more than just a group of people. It's really a brotherhood, and I lucked into that.
Was there initiation? Did they haze you?
There's a little bit of hazing. It wasn't that big of a deal. However, they knew me for years, and we had been body surfing for years. And I originally, when I started body surfing, had a hand plane. That is what I knew. So I was like, okay. They're like, you know, you're not a body surfer. Yeah, exactly. You're not a body surfer if you have a hand plane. And I was like, oh, really? And so the hazing is they basically asked me to be in the comp that they host every year, one that we just finished last weekend. And I think they just actually wanted to shake me down for some money because I had to pay for it. But I showed up, never been in a comp. I mean, I'd been body surfing for a few years, but with a hand plane, so it's not real body surfing. And I showed up and just like low-key won. And they were like, damn, okay. Yeah, very casually won. And it still took another year and a half for them to invite me into the club. So it was just like, really had to pay my dues.
Oh my goodness. And what was their kind of, as you transitioned, what was their, was it like a non-conversation? Were there awkward conversations? Were there like really great conversations that kind of also helped you process your journey? I hate to use the word journey, but for lack of a better word.
Totally. It's interesting because when I came out, my first thing was like, okay, I'm trans. That didn't really take a lot of action. I was like, I'm trans. And everybody's like, okay, let's go surf. There was no, I didn't ask. I didn't change my pronouns. I hadn't had top surgery. I was just like, I think I'm trans. They're like, okay. Right. You know, like, and then there was a non-issue. But when I started taking more steps to publicly and socially transition, it forced those conversations. And so, one of them was going by they, them pronouns. And for a bunch of old white guys, that was not easy. One of them's an English teacher. And I was like, look, we're not going to have this conversation.
grammar conversation. Here,
yeah,
right?
Exactly. So, you know, but the good thing about it was they asked all the wrong questions, but we were comfortable enough that I didn't hold it personally. And so I could field those. I could practice those answers in a safe space. Because I knew I was going to get those questions in other spaces. And especially after I got top surgery, they don't tell you this, but you kind of look like a little bit of an alien because you're just deflated and you don't really look. It's an interesting way to try to get back in body surf when you haven't lifted your arms for 8 weeks. In the parking lot, I'm like trying to get my wetsuit on, but like trying to hide my chest because I'm like, but you guys haven't seen me. It was very awkward for me personally. I was having my own anxieties, not because of what they were doing or saying, but just my own internalized stuff. And it was in those moments where they were just like, I can't wait for you to body surf without a bikini top on. Like, it's going to feel so good. You know, they were just so stoked for me.
Dream on. Like, you're going to go so fast. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. And, you know, they were right. It felt like getting your braces off and you lick your teeth for the first time and it's all slimy. I felt like a slippery little salamander in the water. I was like, oh, this is so rad. And so body surfing was like that conversation that we could reach a common ground, right? They're like, yeah, mm-hmm. it's going to be awkward, but man, you're going to love body surfing in your speedos without a bikini mm. top. So, and they were right. And so they really helped me gain more confidence in that respect too. And around the other guys in the lineup too, like correcting people on my name or my pronouns, like doing some of that work for me and advocating for me in a way that I didn't even expect. And so it was really cool that they stepped up in that way.
I'm like imagining beautiful. Them being like, you're going to love being a dude. Let me tell you, like a guy, like we get all the benefits. We get to do this and that. It's amazing. You know, they cook you dinner.
Hey, you got a joke. You got a lady. I'm joking
here. I'm just being ridiculous. Sorry.
I know. No. And also, you know, to the grammar, to the English teacher, one way it was positioned to me that made so much sense is that when we talk about an individual that we don't know, we have no problems calling them they. So we mm-hmm. have right. that facility. We just, it's just a matter of just shifting and just accepting like, yes, it can happen. And
I wanted to discuss something. Sorry, Karen, but we're on this topic is something that in the film you are, your pronoun is he, him. But in your signature, it is he, him, they, them. And I was hoping you could speak to this for maybe some of our listeners who may not be as familiar with that, you know, in terms of expanding out the binary, you know, and beyond that. And I was hoping you might be able to kind of explain that a little bit more.
Absolutely. And before I explain anything, I just want to say, like, this is for me, right? Every person in the relationship to their gender, their sexuality, their pronouns, and everything else is their individual journey. So I can't speak on behalf of anybody.
Totally.
But for me, when I first came out as trans, I knew deep down I was non-binary. And I'm very masculine presenting. The way I carry myself in the world is, you can't see me, but I'm doing little air quotes, the dude, right? Like, that's how I want to present myself in the world. And I've always been that way, even pre-transition. I've always been masculine. But in my heart of hearts, despite my expression and my gender expression and how I like to be perceived, I know I'm non-binary. And that's just like an internal knowing. I can't explain it other than that. And because of that internal knowing, when I first came out, I hadn't really stepped into the confidence of using he, him pronouns yet, because I hadn't taken any medical or surgical steps to transition. And it's a little bit gatekeepy kind of mentality. But at the time, I was like, I'm going to come out with they, them pronouns because I want to test this out. And also signal that my assumed pronouns are incorrect and have those conversations with people. So when I first came out, my pronouns were they, them. And as I started taking testosterone years later, I met some people that started heeing me because they didn't know any better and I didn't tell them I was trans. And I was like, ooh, this feels really good. I love this. So bring on the he, him pronouns too. For me, it was just like, oh, and this also feels really good. Mm-hmm. But to speak very specifically about why I use both and why I never dropped they, them. When I'm a teacher, I meet new people in the water every day. I'm pretty extroverted, so I love meeting new people and having conversations. When I meet somebody new, I always introduce myself with they, them pronouns because I want to start that conversation or I want to increase the visibility, not just as a trans person, but just because people should just start introducing themselves with their pronouns, and they, them is one of those conversation sparkers. Mm-hmm. And as I become more and more physically presenting as masculine or more stealth, as they would say, people will assume that I'm a male or a cis male, unless I say otherwise. And so the they, them, it makes it a conversation no matter where I'm at in my journey and in my transition. And it makes it safe for those that come to me, like my students specifically. Like when I introduce myself with they, them pronouns, they've already got a sense that I'm a safer person to come mm-hmm. speak with, that I'm a little bit more than the villain white dude, right? I'm more than that. And I say that lightly. I say it kind of with a smile, because I think a lot of guys like the Gillis guys have been villainized. And, you know, there are people out there that really do kind of suck, but you can't lay that across all guys, and you can't lay that across all types of people, right? Just because there's a bad apple or a lot of bad apples even doesn't mean you can't just do a broad stroke over an entire gender or race or religion or whatever, right? There's so much more nuance to that. So for me, it's really about having those conversations and making it more of a point just on a daily basis. That was a long, long answer. Sorry about that.
No, thank you for sharing that. It really helps, I think, for a lot of people to understand a bit more of how we go about identifying ourselves. And I know it's still relatively new in culture in some ways, you know, even though it's the idea and concept, you know, can go back, you know, centuries. It's still, for many people, it's a fresh idea that they are not familiar with. And I think it's great that you present yourself as a they, them, so that to have that conversation and also to provide that safe space for people to feel comfortable with you. It's really, really important. I was curious, like, about your student Alden that is featured in the film. Like, what role did they play in your life and your decision to transition?
Yeah, so Alden graduated from the school at which I teach, oh my gosh, probably 6 years ago now, maybe wow. Seven. Is that right? Yeah, somewhere around there, maybe six. And I teach at an independent school that historically is a girls' school. And so for a trans student to come out as a trans man and then graduate as our first trans male or just our first male is really big. And for me, we were talking earlier about visibility and having vocabulary. I had always known that I was masculine, but I had no idea. I had no concept of gender identity. And so with Alden, we used to hang out in the gym and I'd show him some exercises to get stronger. And I was helping him feel comfortable in his changing body. And he was just blowing my mind with information mm-hmm. on and ways to reflect on how I carry myself and how I have been and questioning me and actually challenging me, which is rad because, you know, I was 20 something at the time. No, I was 30 something at the time. Oh God. And I'm getting questioned by this 16-year-old when he ended up coming out. And I was just open and receptive and it changed the whole trajectory of my life. Wow. And for him, I was just helping him work out, stay in shape, feel confident in his body and give him a space. He's an athlete and he couldn't compete for our girls' sports anymore. So I gave him a space where he could use his body in a way that felt good. And so it was a very symbiotic relationship. I was helping with his physicality and his confidence, and he was helping with my emotional maturity and my confidence.
Just a really quick thing to add to that too. We, in the film, we filmed a Zoom call between Alden and Tyler. And Alden, for your audience who may have not seen the film, incredibly eloquent person. I mean, Alden's also a Harvard graduate. And wow. We got, like, he was just throwing down these just bars of just, like, knowledge, just dropping them left and right. And you're like, oh, my God, like, my goosebumps all over. I grew up Catholic. A large part of his life is in the seminary, too. And I was like, you know, how does your religion... Yeah. conflict or kind of like push off of your gender identity. And then I'm like, oh my God, like Alden could be a whole film in himself, you know? And in my first director's cut, I had a whole section on Alden that was kind of blown out. And then I realized Alden is, again, one ingredient in this like vastness, this galaxy of who Tyler is. And another great proof point of like Tyler's community and how his community has helped enforce or create who he is, but how much he's helped his community become what they are. You know, it's like fucking mind blowing. It's absolutely mind blowing. But I told Tyler after that, I'm like, I got to stay in touch with Alden, just like world's most interesting human being. And such a pleasure to and shout out to Alden if he's listening, but like such a pleasure to have him be a part of this film. It truly made it better.
He like must be so blown away by, I don't know, like to me, like being able to see people change because of your influence, I think is huge. And I don't know, like I, Alden, like it sounds like there's a story there for sure, Peter, that you have. But it also reinforces my faith in the youth will redeem us. You know, I really, they have so, there's so much to learn and there's so much that we can, you know, get from them. There's always, I feel like in a lot of mainstream culture and people of older ilk who poo-poo younger people, but I feel like they have so much to teach us, and it's incredible to hear that story, Tyler, like the impact that Alden had on you.
Yeah,
and I think also, I mean, some people, they just, you know, they come to be with such certainty and boldness. I mean, you know, like that at that age, he just knew and was just like, it seems like he was just like, okay, this is what I need to do what I need to do, you know? And so that kind of rubbed off on you and the people around him as far as like, yeah, this is who he is and this is how he needs to go about in the world and he needs to do A, B, and C. And how do I do that? Oh, I'm going to find Tyler and Tyler's going to help me with this and I'm going to do this and that and the other and all these folks are going to help me. So that kind of certainty and meeting people like that is always so interesting, especially when they're so young.
Yeah, and also modeling. I mean, it takes a lot of courage to ask for help. And I think anybody has experienced that. And so, you know, when he was so courageous in so many ways, not just by doing all the steps like you were saying, because all of those took, you know, they were formidable, being at a girls' school and saying, hey, I want to stay with my friends. This is safe. And this is how we're going to do it. And this is how it's going to go down. And he was calling the shots. Wow. And on one side, there's that side, which was incredible. And there's also the side like, hey, I'm actually having a rough time and I really need some mentorship. Yeah. Can you help me with this so I can feel comfortable in my own body? And it's like, you can have both of those things can be true. And I think it's something that's a part of the human condition, right? Everything can be true at once. You can be thriving and depressed. Mm-hmm. You can be, you know, you can feel like you have everything laid out and you have all your checklist done and all your to-dos, yet you're still, you know, wondering why you can't sleep at night, right? Like everything can be an and, like a yes and, mm-hmm. and not necessarily a but. And so he showed me that, you know, with as far as my identity and my gender identity, it's like, yes, and okay, so you feel this way. And what do you think about this? Have you thought about this? And having that open-mindedness is, I think it's like one of the highlights of these younger generations. It's, they're always like, yeah, and, you know, climate change is this, and, you know, what are we going to do about it? It's not something to, it's not a but. It's not, but I like this, you know, it's okay. So how do we solve? How do we create? How do we innovate? And to be around that, I mean, I just teach PE, right? Like these kids are changing the world. And I think I just got really lucky being in the place where I am.
I don't know if it's just teach PE. I think teacher, as a, you know, you are a role model in many ways. And there was something that he saw in you that he felt he could reach out to you. And I think that is so critical, you know, to be in that position. Cause I mean, you know, you spoke about when you came out when you were younger, and I, you know, my stereotype of Orange County is it's very Christian right, like, you know,
conservative,
not the place, you know, for me, conservative. Like, I grew up in an urban environment and also in the suburbs, and I can tell you the difference between what I experienced in one realm and the other. And the suburbs I hated. And so I can only project that onto what I might assume of Orange County and, you know, what kind of some of the culture that I receive from it. But I can't imagine it was an easy place. You know, I don't know about now, but, you know, maybe when you're coming of age, you know, as someone who was, you know, didn't feel quite, you know, like you fit into whatever the culture was at the time or the expectations. Right.
Well, and I think that's why I didn't come out when I lived down mm-hmm. there. I didn't come out until I left for college. And it wasn't, I was in a upper middle class family. There was some affluency there. I went to a great school. I could walk home safely. That, you know, it, when you think of like a safe childhood, and I have that air quote kind of thing again, Orange County is great. But I did not feel safe even uttering to myself out loud that I was gay, because that would have been, I know that would have been something that would have negatively impacted my sense of safety in that place. And so I just stayed closeted and assimilated and put down a lot of pieces of myself that, you know, that probably could have flourished had I had the courage to do that at the time. So
do you feel like Orange County has changed since in any way? I mean, I feel like there's a little more visibility. You've got like organizations like Queer Surfers.
Head tilt.
And then also it just seems like there's a population shift, you know, in the last election, I think it was like a huge news story where for the first time there are all these districts that voted blue, which was huge for some of the kind of, you know, hardcore red districts before. And so I think that was also a mark of gentrification or you know, just populations from LA maybe expanding beyond, or, you know, it just seems like there are big shifts that were happening. I'm wondering if you could feel that in terms of, you know.
I mean, you hit the nail on the head with like looking at those big trends, right? Like for the first time ever, certain counties voting blue. I think, you know, I have friends in Orange County. They're great people. I can't make a broad stroke generalization on Orange County folks, because I know a lot of really awesome, amazing, open-minded people in Orange County. All I know is that, you know, I have experienced a sense of estrangement there, and like a feeling of not fitting in. Because of my queerness. I didn't have community there. When I grew up down there, there was one gay bar in Laguna Beach called the Boom Boom Room, which closed when I turned 20. And I was like, gah. But that was it. There was no real community. So when you feel so alone, you feel really vulnerable, and that feels unsafe. So I'm sure there's great communities there now. So I'm assuming, just based on more queer communities coming up all over the place, that I'm sure some of them are in Orange County. And I feel like there's a lot of great people in Orange County. I just couldn't make a generalized guess on the overall climate. It was called the Orange Curtain when I grew up, and I think still people refer to it. I'm just going to say that's all I know.
I just want to add one thing really, really, really quickly. We're very fortunate to get some great write-ups in the newspaper, and one of them was a feature story in the Orange County Register. Talk about extending the audience of the film. So many people read that article that have not seen the film, and so many people read that article in the community that weren't a part of that conversation. And so it's cool to have it featured and be part of that scene, that part of the country, that part of California, for those of your listeners who don't even know what Orange County is. The other thing that I really want to impress upon everybody, and Tyler, as like a executive producer, you know, co-creator of the story, really kind of pushed me on, is like, I always, like, as a documentary filmmaker, you always think about the tension in the story. Where's the tension in the story? Mm-hmm. Like, where's the hook? And then where's the tension? And, like, we had the hook. Inherently, Tyler's story has tension. But then we kind of realize that, like, it's okay to have a story about trans joy. It's okay to have a story about someone who's trans that ends up positive. Doesn't mean that Tyler's lived the sunny side of life. Everything's been on easy street, yada, yada, yada. Like, mm-hmm. it's okay to have this. And when you talked about how people have seen the film, it's been like the best joy to me to see people who are trans. I showed this in Marfa, Texas, to a group of non-binary people having a celebration, having like a birthday celebration at a place in Marfa. Mm-hmm. And I was like, check it out. I got this film. You want to watch it? Let's check it out. And one of them pulled me aside and said, hey, like, it's so amazing to see an aspirational story about someone who's trans. And I also happen to be a school teacher, too. And I'm like, oh, my God. Like, talk about nail on the head moment. I'm like, this is also why I always say the film is part of it's our film, that, like, I would not have gotten to that point without Tyler kind of pushing and saying, it's okay to have these things. And Nick putting in some really critical moments of doing the testosterone shots, like, some of those things visually can be hard for people to watch, but, like, it's okay to end on a moment of, like, revelation and optimism and joy. It's and that's what gives people the final point is stoke and getting back to the ocean and back to, like, a place of inclusivity and back to a place where you, if you don't feel like you're welcome, well, you're welcome here and you've got an audience here. And, you know, if you follow us on Instagram at Gender Outlaw Film, we'll respond. We'll be part of your community. You know, if you come out to our screenings, like, next weekend or whenever, like, we'll be there to support you as part of our community. Like, that's the I think, the exciting part of, like, the theme of the film.
Right. I think the idea of visibility is so important because it's in that vein of, if you build it, they will come. And, you know, for... you know, the idea that Orange County is not this binary place, that there are a lot of other people who feel not as comfortable for all those reasons, you know, why you might have felt uncomfortable. You showing yourself out there and, you know, in relationship to the ocean, it's like, oh, wow, there's someone like me out there. And then other people come out of the woodworks and then all of a sudden you have, you know, people organizing groups to go body surfing or, you know, just to meet up or whatever. It's just like putting it out there and it's like a call to action to, like, here I am and I know you're out there and let's all kind of be together. I think about, you know, I'm doing a documentary about the early 90s lesbian kind of moment. And that was the moment of, like, the AIDS crisis and this kind of moral mandate in the community for people to come out of the closet to show that we're everywhere. And that is literally what happened when people started coming out, more people came out and all of a sudden it was like, oh my God, everybody is gay. There are so many gay people in the world, you know? So I think it's that visibility and knowing that there are others out there that really kind of rally folks. So films like this are so important to see, to know that, there, you know, oh wow, there's people like me out there. And, you know, I think it will only kind of open the door for more people to make themselves known, to make more content, to, you know, begin the conversation in their communities and find other like-minded folks, you know?
Yeah. And I 100% agree with you on that. And it's, I think there's some statistics out now that I think like 40% of some of people of the population can say that they know someone who is trans. And that is a huge number. Yeah. And it's not because it's not because it's trending. It's because people are feeling comfortable coming out for once. Right. And there's visibility and there's that, and there's putting names and words and vocab to feelings that might have been suppressed, like for me. And the other part about putting out this film, and I'll touch to what Peter said, how I pushed a little bit to make it a feel good story, is that the whole story of, like, I'm trans and courageous and strong because I've overcome so much stuff. It's such a trope. Like, okay, yes, I'm tired of the hero story. Can we talk? Can we forego the, yes, it's hard. But there's lots of hardships that people overcome, especially trans people. But I'm tired of that story. I want to know about somebody who's thriving and has a great community and is living their life and loving their life. And I can assume that they probably had a hard way to get there, but I don't need to focus on that. It's not mm-hmm. like you're great and you're a cool trans person because you overcame it. It's like, no, it's just, you're just a cool human and you got a cool story. And at the end of the day, this is a body surfing film because body surfing is pretty cool. According to me, you know.
Me too. I'll back you up on that.
And we will be right back. And now back to our show.
What's the kind of trajectory of the film from here on out? Are you hitting all the festivals? Like, are you trying to land a distribution deal? Like, what's your journey with this film from here on out?
So, well, I'll jump in and I'll say, like, number one, it's already success. Like, where we're at right now is success. So everything is kind of like a stacking moment on top of that, which is great. You know, again, spirit of optimism. The cool thing is, as we've had several local screenings. We're going to do another one in another week from now. Each time we do that, again, it's another celebration. It's another moment. We've had great time also, again, raising money for Trans Latina Coalition, which is a benefactor of the film. But the cool thing is these festivals, right? So we won Best Short Documentary in the Berlin Indie Film Festival, which is like amazing. Germans love body surfing. Who knows? Facts. All good. We got second in the
coolest, yeah,
in the Include Film Festival, which celebrates diversity in film. We're going to be in the Santa Cruz Film Festival. We were just in the Montauk nice. Film Festival. We're going to be in the Honolulu Rainbow Film Festival. Amazing. That's another one coming up soon. So we are doing the festival circuit, but the greatest thing about that is, like, especially like Montauk is a really good example of this. You know, that was a few weeks ago in our time. Getting to see the audience experience that film and getting to hear people who saw the film screen at the event at the Hero Beach Club, shout out. It's like rad. You know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of times, again, kind of where I feel like we're in a bit of an echo chamber with Twitter and with Instagram and with like having some of these local screenings. It's like, you know, definitely have like friends and family and stuff coming by, but to get like the East Coast crew down on it, the German crew on it, you know, the Honolulu crew on it. It's cool because all of a sudden you realize it's like, hey, you know what? I got homies all over the world and they're all kind of preaching the same thing. And we're all backing each other up. And the coolest thing is, like, you know, one of the people, Dean, who runs the Honolulu Rainbow Film Festival, reached out last night. He's like, yeah, I'm a 70-year-old body surfer. I love this film. I absolutely love this film. Aww. And I'm like, shout out. And basically he's like, anytime you're on the North Shore, go to Velsiland with us. Let's go for a body surf. I'm like,
hey.
If there's any intent of this film, it's to create a broader community and really have more places for Tyler and I to travel and go surf with other people, you know?
That is always the real goal of all of this.
Isn't that always it? Just to get more waves.
It's a vibe, you know? It's totally a vibe. Why not? Why not? Why not go find some good waves in Germany? Why not?
There are, you know, and you got the Eisbach, you know?
There you go.
I don't know if you can, I wonder if you could body surf that river.
Oh, you know what? One last thing I was going to mention. The distribution thing is really interesting because, like, we've talked about this film maybe even being a package of films. But, you know, a lot of it's still in conversation. Tyler's a big part of that conversation. We've had some great friends at other big distributors and big name streaming places and talking about, like, how that could be placed there. You know, we haven't landed some of those conversations yet, but that's fine. Tyler's main goal out of this, and he's told me this on the side, is like, just want people to watch the film. So the more people we can get to watch the film, the better. You know, whether if there's a financial bump at the end of this, my Lord, we're all like stoked. Believe me, money can move mountains and also pay for more other movies, which is great. But and just getting, and surf trips, right? Get back in the ocean. But the fact that we can get more people to watch it in any sense of world, whether through screenings, whether through festivals or through distribution, is definitely a future conversation. But it's exciting because the more people that watch it, the more of a response we get and the more we carry the momentum of the conversation forward, which is what we're doing here today.
Well, I feel like with particularly going to surf film festivals, it's a great way to expose a lot of audiences who may not be talking about this topic. And again, like you said, showing it in such a positive light, I think it's a really important thing to kind of expand out in those ways. And I think it's going to be really well received, you know? And if you need help with any film festivals, I know a few of them, you know, so I'm on a jury on one or two.
Inside track. We'll take it.
You know,
also,
but I do
like the idea of it extending beyond the film, the surf film festivals.
100%.
Also, just, of course, you know, like queer visibility in all these different spaces. Like, we don't just exist in this one way.
100%. And the whole vibe and getting back to like the core of this is a surf film, right? Like, and Tyler really pushed on that. I pushed on that. Everyone kind of pushed on that. Our editor, God bless Nick Gardner, he didn't know much about surf, but we were like, this is better surf, right? But the message, the undercurrent, the message of trans joy, so important. But what a great way to package it within surf so that people within the surf community who don't know anything about the queer community could watch this film and then be like, whoa, like this moment of like alertness that, wow, I don't know someone who's trans, or maybe I do. And now I understand a little bit more about their journey, or I'm open to that conversation. And I can guarantee you, when we did our first premiere at the Hermosa Beach Museum, shout out, it was amazing to see the audience there because it was such a mix of the surf community, the queer community, docents who just kind of are there to volunteer for the night. And then they're all coming up and being like, wow, what a great film, you know? And I think that's the beauty of combining two topics that have sit so far on the fringes of society and banding them together to say, hey, brother, hey, sister, right hand, left hand, we celebrate so much more in common. And look at this. This is a perfect sort of marriage of both of those things together. And what a way to celebrate, you know, both in these screenings, but, you know, every time we have a chance to watch the film with people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, like, to piggyback on that, you think about The Endless Summer, right? It sold out in Kansas in the middle of winter, and people were lined up in the snow. It's not because they love surfing, right? There was something about that film that people can relate to. And I'm not saying we're Endless Summer, we're our own Gender Outlaw, but hopefully this film can transcend surfing, body surfing, and it's just something that people want to watch because they can relate to it in their own way. Whether it's gender, it could be age, it could be just seeking stoke, it could be community, overcoming and, you know, any adversity, whatever it is, if you're searching for something, hopefully this film speaks to you and gives you a little bit of hope that you can find that community that you're looking for, right? And so I think overall, it's more about everybody has the ability to be stoked every day, and you gotta look for it, and you gotta find the people, and you gotta do the work, and everybody deserves to have that experience and to see that kind of beauty each day.
Well, it's about surfing is the vehicle, you know, that's the thing, you know, surfing is a vehicle to tell a much more in-depth story, I think, you know, and that's the beauty of it. It surfing hooks you on the visuals and everything. And then what carries it is this story of yours, Tyler, which I think is really key. Sorry, Karen, didn't mean to cut you off there.
Oh, no, I was just going to say about sharing the stoke. Tell us about this organization that you are highlighting for folks to share their stoke with. Tell us about your why this organization is called out to you, and, you know, why it's important to support them. What's the work that they do?
Yeah, so Trans Latina Coalition, their home base is in L.A., and I first became aware of them because my school did a fundraiser for them and we did makeup kits. And so I was like, all right, let me go deliver these makeup kits to this organization. And then when I went there, they welcomed me and they were like, let us tell you about what we do. And my mind was blown. Mm-hmm. It's an organization that was founded by Bambi Salcedo. And she is a refugee, like a lot of the women who work there, from places in South America that have had to fight for their life just to get to the border. They're fleeing certain death or persecution. And when they get to the border, they have to turn themselves in and be in detention, seek asylum. And if all that goes to plan, they can get into the States and literally have nothing. And they don't have their gender markers, they don't have legal names, they don't have birth certificates, and they don't have any protections whatsoever. And so I can't imagine this type of, I mean, I know my life and my journey as a trans person, and needless to say, I have a lot of privilege. And so these women, not only have they made it to where they made it, but they created an organization that is saving the lives of so many other trans Latina women. And they work with all types of folks. But if we think about intersectionality and how the different intersections of our gender, race, ethnicity, citizenship, all that play into the amount of privilege we have, these women really came from less than nothing, like not even a legal status to fight for healthcare, right? And so they created something out of nothing and are doing the work that no one else will do. They're supporting each other. They've created a community for each other, with each other. They're hiring each other. And it's just like such an amazing, and they're so, like they're such amazing people. They're fabulous. They're fiery. They're feisty. And they're just doing life. And I was so inspired by them. And my mom's also Colombian. I don't look it. I don't sound it. But I'm also Latino. And so it just like, it checked all the boxes for me. And really raising up, specifically raising up the voices of people that are the most marginalized. When we work on, mm-hmm. you know, supporting those that need the most help, then everybody gets better. I truly believe that. And so when we focus on organizations like Trans Latina Coalition, everybody gets supported. Everybody gets better from that. And so that's why I brought Peter in to work with them and why we want them to be our, you know, benefactor of the film.
I just want to give a quick, again, shout out to Trans Latina Coalition too, because without them, this film really wouldn't have been possible. There's so many people who have been drawn to their story and drawn to Tyler's story mm-hmm. that have also donated their time and expertise from editing to shooting to Squeaky Clean, who did the music as well. You know, knowing that there's a great benefactor of a story, I think is great. And then for Tyler, when Tyler came to me and said, because I proposed the idea of tying a nonprofit to the film, when Tyler gave me this sort of like pitch on Trans Latina and we did the research, I was like, man, this is amazing. Like, you know, this money, small donation, you know, thousands of dollars, like, but it will go to feeding people who don't have a meal, you know, to putting a roof over someone's head that doesn't have a place to sleep. Like literally, like, you know, I can go get a latte if I want, you know what I mean? I have a pool, mm-hmm. you know, like, I'm living a very privileged life. Like there are people who have showed up on America's doorstep with absolutely nothing. But on top of that are transgender and they're up against so much persecution. Literally give them a warm meal, a place to sleep and a place to like at least like a pair of shoes to start their life in the US to become something. That's all, like all you ask for is and again, like don't want to be religious, but if you were religious, like give that love back to someone. That's love. That's spirit. You know, like that's the truest form of it. So I've been so impressed with them. And we showed their one of their films at our first screening, and we got to meet some of the people there, and we're coordinating a moment to go to their office and actually give them a donation from all the money that we've raised from the events and from swag and from everything else. So I'm super stoked to do that and super thankful for them.
Oh, that's great.
Where can our listeners find them? How can they donate and help?
I think the easiest way is to go to translatinacoalition.org, and right on that homepage, just click donate. You can do a lot. They do a lot of, if you're in LA, they march down and they do a lot of stuff at City Hall. There's protests. They're really fantastic organizers. So if you want to show up in your person, you know, as part of the community, that's also a great way to support. But honestly, they've got so much going on. They allow, they give prep to people. They do mental and health services. They're helping people get their documentation. They're getting them lawyers so they can get their political asylum. So, and all that costs money. And so the easiest way to just ensure that you're doing the best for them is to throw them a few bucks. And it goes a long way.
Well, thank you for putting them on our radar.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, I guess folks should follow you on your social media to find out when the next screenings might be and when they might be able to see it online if they can't get to a screening.
So here's the plug.
Okay. I'm going to jump into a plug and I want Tyler to back me up on it. Tyler, you got to be my hype machine here. But yeah, follow us on Instagram, Gender Outlaw Film. Very active on Instagram. And we've got lots of local screenings with music and beer and cool people and everything. We're also on Twitter, The Gender Outlaw. So a different handle there. And it is globally available online, Vimeo on demand. So you can just search for Gender Outlaw Body Surfing Story. And to that extent too, like you can find it through our socials or you can find it through Google. Boom. Check it out, Karen. Karen's following. Boom. We got enough followers. That's amazing. But just Googling, you'll find some great write-ups. We just got wrote up by Include. They did a review on the film. We've been written up, like I said, Orange County, Register, Beach Reporter. But we've just been super thankful to have some people in the editorial community back up the story with great reviews as well. But yeah, please give us a follow, a like, and a subscribe.
And what's next for both of you? Is there any plans after this besides go for a surf?
I mean, I just started. I'm back on campus teaching, so we haven't started classes yet. But I'm a strength and conditioning coach too, so I'm working with my athletes and doing the work. And that's what I got going on. That and trying to score some late south swell, hopefully coming through. It's been some fun wind swell lately, so who knows? Maybe we'll get another significant south coming through, and I'll be dawn patrolling it for the rest of the school year.
Amazing. I have my own creative production consulting company called Crossstep Content. Give us a follow on Instagram. We get swag, do events, everything else. And, you know, definitely looking forward to telling more stories in the future. But to be honest, this is like a huge project. And I always think like the positive momentum that builds off of something naturally that has a great direction and positivity behind it, it's become kind of Tyler and I's side job. So there is a lot more, you know, like they say, when you make a film, there's a journey to make the film, but then the beginning of screening it and beginning of sharing it is the beginning of that journey. So we're actually like just in the beginning stages of that. And there's a lot more ahead on that side. So I just say, stay tuned, give us a follow, and you know, you can experience what we're going through in real time, which is great.
Yeah. And to speak to that, there's so many communities that have been popping up and just so many people have been reaching out. And so we're really in this just like casting a net. And this is like why we're here too, right? We just kind of found each other and like-minded people. And we're just trying to light that fire to get more people organized and hanging out and creating this like global community that supports one another. And as that gets bigger, then hopefully the demand for this film and for our time is more too. And we're happy to donate it for that greater cause.
Amazing.
Right on.
Both of you, thank you so much. Like really, I know Karen and I both really appreciate your time and the work that you're doing. And this film is amazing. Listeners, like if you can't get to a film festival, it's on demand. So, and the money goes to a good cause. So you feel good. The movie makes you feel good already. You just get a little extra bump of feel good on top of that. So go check it out. And Karen, good to see you.
Good to see you too. It's good to meet you all. Thank you so much for joining us today and sharing your stories. It was really wonderful. And thank you for sharing the stoke.
Thank you for having us, guys. Thank you.
And for all the listeners, you can follow us at Swell Season Surf Radio. And you can go to swellseasonsurfradio.com. And we'll see you all down the line soon.